Lord, everybody. Amen. Good to see everybody here this morning, in spite of all the rain and the cold. It's like we went from June to October overnight. Well, I want to start out this morning with something a little unusual and kind of selfish, but I get that chance to do it, so I'm just going to go ahead and do it. Praise the Lord. I was in praying Tuesday night, and the Lord had spoke some things to me, and I thought I understood what he was saying, but maybe not. That wouldn't be the first time I'd misunderstood. But I want to say this. Unless everybody knows my wife, Sally, and I wish everybody was here, but so they would all hear this, but I'm going to say it anyway just because I want to, and I feel like I need to, and it'll embarrass her, and she'll probably have a discussion with me about this later, but praise the Lord. I'm going to just let it go anyway. She's my wife, and of course I love her, and there are times when I said this Wednesday night, and all of you that are married understand what I'm talking about, because sometimes things are said about me or things are said to me, and either I'm too dense to really get it, or I just don't really care about it. It doesn't bother me that much. So a lot of times, Sally is more offended than I am. And she has a tendency to react and respond. And I appreciate it. Not because I always want her to do it, but because it shows me that she's kind of looking out for me. You know, she's watching my back. We all do that. That's the way husbands and wives are. It's the way families are, in fact. You know, we might say things to one another, but nobody else is going to say that to us or about ours, you know. I mean, that's the way it is. But I just wanted to say that, you know, in Acts, you see, Sally's not a speaker. Some of you at the ladies' conference found this out. But what she is obedient to the Lord.
Yes.
And I respect that, because the hardest thing for her to do is get up in front of people. And yet she did it anyway. And the Lord spoke to me. In fact, I told Sally about it afterwards. I said, you know, I was praying about the situation, because I know my wife, you know. But the Lord spoke to me and said, you know, this is not taking anything away from everybody else or anything anybody else did. I'm just talking about my wife this morning, you know. And what the Lord told me was, it was just like the widow's mite. There were a lot of things given, and it was all good that what people gave. But he saw what Sally gave as the greatest sacrifice, because it was the hardest thing for her to do. Now, how many of you know? I mean, you all been in situations where you had to do something. You didn't really want to do it. You weren't comfortable doing it, but you felt like, I got to do this, you know. That takes courage. And there's nothing wrong with being afraid. It's just, what's wrong with it is allowing that fear to dominate you or to keep you from being and doing what God's telling you to do. And because of that, I have the greatest respect for Sally. You know, in the book of Acts, in chapter 6, it talks about Philip and Stephen. And it said the apostles, they went and looked out for some people that were full of the Holy Ghost that would do the serving so that they could focus on the Word of God and so on and so forth. So they found people that were full of the Holy Ghost, and the fact it says, and so that they would then serve the people, and miracles and wonders were done by these servants, by these people who were not up front and getting a lot of attention, but they were just doing the thing that needed to get done. And that's my wife. She's not looking for attention. In fact, she's not comfortable with a lot of attention. But she does what needs to be done. She takes care of all the books for the church. I'm not real good at that, because I'm not disciplined when it comes to things like that. But she is. And she does a great job. You all get your tithing reports, and she takes care of all of that stuff, all of the records, all the day in and day out kind of stuff that has to be done. And she doesn't ask for attention for it. She doesn't ask for a paycheck, pat on the back, or anything else. In fact, Jesus said about himself, he said, you know, there's Who is the greater? The one that's being served or the one that serves? And he said, the greater one's the one being served. But then he said, but I've come to serve you. So he's elevating everybody else by him being what he felt he needed to do, and that was to serve, to show how we operate with one another.
Yes.
And that's, again, that's Sally. Now, Sally, it's not that she doesn't hear from God, because she does. In fact, she wouldn't have gotten up here except that God spoke to her. She didn't want to be up here, but God wanted her to do it, and so she did it.
Amen.
I wouldn't be pastoring this church, to be quite honest with you, if Sally hadn't heard from the Lord. Because I was in prayer about it after I was asked to take the church and so forth. And I really wasn't looking for a church. I wasn't looking to pastor again. I was in sales. I was traveling all the time. And I was praying, and I said, Lord, we didn't have a discussion about it. I said, unless Sally broaches this subject with her approval, I'm not going to take it. I'm not going to do it. I come home late on a Friday night after being gone all week, and one of the first things she said to me after she got my check, just kidding. I'm just kidding. Praise the Lord. But one of the first things she said to me was, the Lord told me that you're supposed to take this church. And I knew she really wasn't ready to go through all this again, because we'd already been down that road, and praise the Lord.
Yeah.
But that was her saying yes to God and making it possible for me to say yes to God. Yeah. So I'm blessed by the wife that I have. Sally prayed for my sister when she had cancer. This has been 25 years ago now. My sister was a Baptist, didn't believe in divine healing. She's a very godly woman, loved the Lord, but didn't believe in that stuff. The Lord spoke to Sally to go and pray for her, because she had come back from Iowa City and had a tumor the size of a grapefruit in her stomach area. And Sally knew it was going to be difficult to go and pray for her, but God told her to go and do it, because my sister wasn't receptive to this kind of stuff. And especially coming from us being these crazy Pentecostals that they didn't have a whole lot of respect for. But Sally went anyway and prayed for her. That week following Monday, or first part of the following week, my sister went back to Iowa City for another ultrasound and a scan. The tumor had shrunk from the size of a grapefruit to the size of an acorn.
Come on.
Yeah.
And it changed my sister's, not just her view of us, but more importantly, her understanding of God and what God wants to do in people's lives and what God is capable of doing. And it wouldn't have happened if Sally hadn't put her fears aside and went ahead and did what God asked her to do. So she's an encouragement to me. She prays for me. She prays with me. The cushions that you're sitting on, Sally made them. The backdrop, the curtains up here, Sally made those. I'll just say this. 1 Corinthians 1, 26 and, through 31, I'm not quoting this, but just paraphrasing, it says, God chose what looks in the natural to be small things, insignificant things, and uses them for his glory. So I'm not just talking about Sally, but I'm talking to the rest of you that may have some issues when it comes to stepping out and doing things. Even if you have to do it afraid, just do it.
Yes.
There's all sorts of gifts in this church and the possibility for God to do a lot of things. And maybe you're kind of like my wife and a little, you know, uncomfortable in those settings. And I'm not saying you have to get up and lead service and you have to do this or the other, but just be obedient. Just be willing. If God asks you to pray for somebody, go and pray for them. It doesn't have to be a big production. You just go and do it. If he gives you a word for somebody, just encouragement. You know, prophecy is not just telling the future. Prophecy in 2 Kings, it said, or 1 Kings, it says, so he sent the guy, let me just read this to you. The messenger that was gone to call Micaiah spake unto him, saying, "Behold now, the words of the prophets declare good unto the king with one mouth. Let thy word, I pray thee, be like the word of one of them, and speak that which is good." And Micaiah said, "As the Lord liveth, what the Lord saith unto me, that will I speak." Paul said, "I would that you all prophesy." He wasn't saying that you all foretell future events and you know, all of a sudden become a book of Revelation, but you speak good to other people.
Yes.
You speak love to other people. That's the God in us. That's what God wants to do. And that's the sure sign, the true sign of prophecy. And so I know God is in this because I'm speaking love, and I'm speaking to my wife, but I'm also speaking about my wife. So if anybody, you know, thinks, well, you know, Sally doesn't do anything. It isn't that Sally doesn't do anything. Sally just doesn't care if everybody knows what she's doing. Unlike some of the rest of us, praise the Lord, hallelujah, glory to God. Amen. Sometimes, and I'll just stop with this because I know she's totally humiliated at this point, but it's the only chance I can get away with this because she can't get at me, praise the Lord. But sometimes durability is actually better than ability. When I first started preaching, I had the greatest fear of getting up in front of people. That's why one of the reasons I drank as much as I did was because I was in sales, and you got to deal with people all the time. And that was my biggest problem, was interacting with people or having to deal with people face to face. I don't know where it came from, but I just know that's the way it was. But the Lord gave it to me, and I did the first, gosh, I don't know, for a long time, I did it afraid. Even today, I don't get up here without praying and believing God because I don't know. I know what I'm capable of, and it's not that great. It's not pretty, praise the Lord. But I need God, and I've just learned over the years, if I trust him, even if I don't do well, I'm not freaked out about it. You know, I don't condemn myself. I don't spend the rest of the month. I might spend the afternoon a little depressed, but I won't get past. I'll be past it by the next day. You know, I'll just move on. But that's what I've learned over time, is durability carry you when your ability won't. If you just do, God will give the ability. Amen. So, amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to have opportunities as time goes on for people to minister to one another. I hope you will in any service that the Lord leads you to. And again, I think sometimes we think, you know, we're always thinking in terms of the spirit realm, but that's what we are. It's not like we have to make ourselves do something spiritual. If we're doing it and it isn't, you know, contrary to the word of God, it's a spiritual act. So God may be speaking to somebody or may speak to somebody in the future to say something positive to somebody. And we don't do it because it seems so mundane. That's prophecy. That's what these prophets, that was the criteria by which they went by. He said, they speak good to the king. So do what the prophets do. Speak good. Amen. Tell somebody, I appreciate you. Love you. God's got a good plan for your life. God wants to bless you. There's not, you know, that's true. Amen. It's true. You don't have to have a vision to know that. That's the will of God for all of us. Sometimes we just need to be reminded of it. Amen. Sometimes we're just going through so much crap that we forget that God is on our side, that God does want to bless us, that God does want to help us, that God is involved in our situations, even when it doesn't seem like it. So, praise the Lord. Speak prophecy.
Amen. Amen.
Speak prophetically. Amen. Speak faith. Speak love. Speak good things. Praise the Lord. I prophesied this morning.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. I'm feeling really spiritual right now. Can you see? Is there like a glow, a cloud over me or something? Praise the Lord.
Hello.
Hallelujah. That's all I'm saying. We can do that for others. We need to do it, especially for those that are closest to us. because they're the ones we take for granted. Because we're just around them all the time. It's just, you know, you just get used to it and you just figure, well, they know I love them. Sometimes we need to say it, and sometimes we need to show acts of love for them so that they can experience more than just a word from here and there. Amen? Everybody say praise the Lord. Thank you for listening. Praise God. I just wanted to get that off my chest, and now I'm good to go for another 6 months. And I think that may have saved me a bouquet of flowers for Mother's Day. Or it may have cost me two. Praise the Lord. So, hallelujah. Amen. It's all good in Jesus. Give the Lord a hand this morning. Praise God. Amen. Again, I want to thank you all for being here. And how about, Ron, would you come and take up the offering for us this morning? Praise the Lord. I think one guy can do it. We don't have that many people here, so praise the Lord. And I'll let you go ahead and pray over the offering. Amen. God bless you as you give. Praise God. If you're unable to give, don't be embarrassed. Just trust the Lord that He's going to give you seed to sow. And your opportunity to give and to receive will come from the Lord. Amen. He is faithful. Praise God. Amen. We're going to go right to worship now, so if the worship team will come. Let's just love the Lord now for a little bit. Let's prophesy to Jesus. Tell Him how much we love Him and appreciate Him. Praise God.
transform that now. He wants to transform that. He's trying to renew our minds. The way we think about things. Last weekend I got to watch ladies step out in the women's conference and they did an awesome job. And I believe it was a step of faith for many. But this is just the beginning. Not only with the ladies, but with the gentlemen. I saw some of the wild side. I saw some of these sparks start to fly. By the end of the conference, I saw some of the videos from the back end of it. Things were just starting to warm up. Too bad we would have won another 4 hours. I think this place would have been on Holy Ghost fire. I'm hearing rumblings. I was understanding that originally this might have been an angle event, but I don't think they're going to wait that long. I think there's going to be something in the fall. Even you young ladies who weren't here, I want to encourage you. I've seen the spirit of Deborah, the Deborahs. I've seen the Esthers. I've seen those rising up. If you don't know who those people are, talk to your mom or grandma about it. They'll
Praise the Lord. Let's lift our hands to the Lord right now and praise Him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your glory, for your goodness, for your mercy. Thank you for your love, Lord. Thank you for your reality. Thank you, Jesus. You are a great and a mighty God, and there is none like you. And you alone are worthy of all of our praise and all of our worship. And we give that to you this morning, Lord, in every part of this service, Lord. We want you to be worshiped. We want you to be focused on you, to show your glory. Everybody said, praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you all. Thanks, Mike. Thanks, worship team. We ought to give them a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Praise God. They do a great job. Really appreciate Mike and all the hard work he puts into making these things happen. Hallelujah. Yes, we want to thank the Lord for Rick. He's back. Amen. Had gallbladder surgery. Praise the Lord. God has restored him. Hallelujah. And we're grateful to the Lord for that. Praise God. Amen. We're just believing that God's just going to continue to complete his perfect work in Rick. Praise God. Amen. Why don't everybody just take a second, if you didn't get a chance to earlier, just shake somebody's hand, say hello, say praise the Lord, glad to see you here. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Okay, turn them loose. Hallelujah. All right, praise the Lord, everybody. Find a seat. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We appreciate it. Everybody being here. And we're going to, once everybody finds their way back to their seat, we'll take some prayer requests. Praise the Lord. I think my mic is on, isn't it? Okay, praise the Lord. Yeah. Makes me feel like home. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. All right. Praise God. Prayer requests. Hallelujah. Anybody have one this morning? Yes. Let me see if I can. Oh, Jane. I couldn't see you for Alvin. Praise the Lord.
I'd like to ask prayer for one of Donnie's brothers. He's had some poor health in the last couple of years, and he is a strong believer, but he's got this, you know, thing working on him that he's really in poor health.
Yeah. All right. Praise the Lord. Sheila.
Let's continue to remember Evelyn in prayer. She says that the Lord will restore her joy. I don't know where it went to. But
yeah. Praise the Lord.
Okay, the Lord's joy, so where's joy? The lady who got healed of diverticulitis issues, but he would like to come and visit, and he just doesn't know if he'd be welcome or whatnot, but, you know, the Lord is able to restore his mind as much as possible. And
praise the Lord.
And his name is Roger, so if we could keep him in prayer as
absolutely.
Well.
You can just tell him everybody's welcome. Praise the Lord. We all got a past. Praise the Lord. Sally. Praise the Lord. I know a couple of little fat guys here in this country need prayer for too. Hallelujah. But yeah, I know what you're saying. Sure. Prayer can change anything.
It can.
Amen. Anybody else? Yeah, Dan.
John Thomas is a co-worker. He had bladder cancer, but he got it all out. But he had some problems the other day. I hope it's just a cold or whatever. But pray that he returns with good health.
Amen. Anybody else? Yes, Rita.
I'd like prayer for Josh. I'm not going to get into, you know, what's going on, but
okay.
God knows.
Yes, amen. Yes. Alvin?
Yeah, I have a granddaughter that, I suppose a couple months ago, she was down in mission work in Texas, and working or something, and she bumped her head terribly, and she thought she could just kind of get over it herself, but it turned off, you know, worse, and the family went down and picked her up. She has trouble with any kind of noise or bright lights, and, you know, she is progressing, but it seems like it's a long way to go yet. She's a young girl, and name's Anna, and praise the Lord.
Amen. God is able. Let me just start by this. How many of you know God knew this situation before you brought it up, right?
Yeah.
Amen. I mean, it's not like we're giving him information, right? We're just making this known to each other and one another. God wants us to bring these things to him because it honors God, it glorifies God, and it gives us confidence that he does answer prayer. But I think we need to sometimes look at what prayer is. I'm not against the traditional, you know, praying and asking God to do things. But on the other hand, every prayer request that I heard here this morning is the will of God is that they be met, that need would be met. Whatever it is, whether it's deliverance from fear and healing, whether it's the healing for this young woman, whether it's the situation that Rita spoke of or Dan, God is totally aware of the specific need. And he knows stuff we don't even know about it. We might pray, you know, that we think we know that this is what needs to be done. And in fact, God really knows what the heart of the issue is, what really needs to be dealt with. You know, in Ezekiel chapter 37, at the beginning of that, God asks a question. And I think he asks it of us every time we do this, whether we're really conscious of it or not. And he looks at a dismal, seemingly hopeless situation, and he says, and he's looking at the valley of dry bones, right? And he says to the guy that he's talking to, Ezekiel, he says, can these bones live? So can Josh's situation be fixed? Can Anna's? Can your brother-in-law's? Can Tom's? Right? We know that nothing's impossible with God, and that's basically what Ezekiel says, Lord, you know. But then God says something that's really powerful. He said, then speak to him. He didn't say, beg me to do this now. He didn't say, ask me to do anything. He said, speak to them. You speak to them because here's the will of God. I want them to rise up. I want them to be healed. I want them to be delivered. I want this valley of dry bones to rise up and be a great army. So we know what God wants. And now God, what God is saying is, you don't have to ask me anymore. How about speak to the valley? How about speak to that situation? Because God has given us authority on this earth.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And we come sometimes, and I understand it because I'm just like everybody else. You know, you look at the situation and we get overwhelmed. We get kind of stunned by the circumstance. But see, if we take us out of the picture more or less and just make this about, we know what God's will is, let's just speak that will. Let's prophesy to them. Let's declare what God has said, that by my stripes they were healed. I want you to be whole. I want you to be restored. I want you to live a long and a healthy life. Amen. It's the will of God. So let's do that. When we're praying, we're not going to pray I'm not going to pray a specific prayer, but y'all pray for the individual, and all the rest of us are going to just speak to the situation, and we're going to declare God's will be done. We know what God's will is, that they're going to be delivered, that they're going to be healed, right? So let's agree together, and let's talk to the mountain. Let's speak to the mountain, amen, in faith, and watch God move it. Praise the Lord. So, Father, we just come before you right now with the greatest confidence, because our confidence is not in our prayer. Our confidence is in your will. Your grace, Lord, we put confidence in your grace. It's your will to defeat the enemy, to overcome sickness, disease, fear, anguish, brokenness in every area of life. So we speak Christ into the situation. We declare that person will live. They will rise up. They will be blessed. They will experience the anointing and the power of the Most High God. Hallelujah. Nothing, Father, is impossible with you. And we speak to those situations right now that you were aware of before we ever got here. And we give you the glory and the honor and the praise for the testimonies that will come as a result of what you're doing in their life this very moment, God. The Spirit of God is ministering and moving in their life. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Now we ought to just give him thanks for that. Praise God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And I just encourage you, every time that person comes to your mind and to your spirit, just speak the Word of God. Just speak God's finished work in their life. They will live and not die. They will be made whole. They will overcome. Amen. They will be healed and walk in wholeness and fullness. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right. Praise God. Let's go to the Word of God this morning. I'd like to start in John chapter 16, and I'm going to read verses 13 and 14. John 16, verses 13 and 14. Praise God. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. Praise the Lord. All right, Ephesians chapter 4. Verses 13 through 16, Roberto. Ephesians 4, verses 13 through 16. Praise God. I really believe God's wanting to do some supernatural, as far as the world is concerned, but natural for us in each one of our lives. In order for God to do what God has declared that he will do, in fact has done, but will do in terms of time, he needs us to operate in agreement with him. He needs us to stop doing the church and doing Jesus. Praise the Lord. Now, I know we're going to do stuff here because that's what you got to do. You got to have, you know, some way of kind of entering into that. But what we're trying to do through everything that we do here, I'm hoping, and my intention is to get us to get focused on the Lord and allow him to do what only he can do anyhow. Praise the Lord. all of us are flawed. Some of us more clearly than others, if I can say it that way. But actually, we're all flawed. Now, we may have specific flaws that bother us more than others. Can I get an amen? Praise the Lord. But it doesn't work that way with God. Amen? So one person may have a judgmental attitude. God loves them. God forgives them. God gives them grace. Somebody else may have something that brings judgment. But God loves them. God forgives them. God wants them to be whole. Somebody else might have an anger problem. Somebody else might have some other issue. We all got stuff. Some of us got multiple stuff. But God doesn't see us in the stuff. He sees us past the stuff. And we've got to get to the place where we see ourselves that way, or we don't ever physically get past it, even though spiritually we've already been delivered. Praise the Lord. I guess that's just me and Sally. Hallelujah. Pray for us. Hallelujah. Declare over us. Hallelujah. All right. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and to the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. The unity of the faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man. That man, that's humanity there. That's not gender specific, all right? Unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. There's another place in the scripture where it talks about the whole earth moans and groans awaiting the manifestation of the sons of God. Everything in this planet, including that fat little guy in Korea, amen, they need a manifestation of the sons of God. Praise the Lord. That's us. So, measure the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. And I'd say verse 14 is worth a huge portion of the body of Christ is. Praise the Lord. Till we all come into the unity of the faith, the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men, cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. The whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. So what does it mean to be a child of God? Do we really have a clue? Do we really understand who we are? Praise the Lord. Look at Colossians, Roberto, 1, verses 26 and 27. We've looked at this scripture a lot, but it doesn't hurt to go back over it. It is the word of God. Amen. Colossians 1, verses 26 and 27. Even the mystery which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known, that's us, what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, we make mental assent to this all the time. I mean, we know that's what happens when a person gets born again. But do we don't live that way. You know, we acknowledge it on Sunday and Wednesday, amen, and occasionally, you know, if we're in a situation where we're praying about something or whatever, but the rest of the time, this is just not reality. It's not reality for us. But unless it becomes reality for us, reality won't change. Amen? Your reality will still be sickness. It'll still be poverty. It'll still be defeat. It'll still be bondage. It'll be all the things, amen, that we've been delivered from, that Christ wants to do in us and through us. Praise the Lord. See, till we really understand this, We're living a masquerade. Praise the Lord. That's what it becomes. So look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 14, Roberto. Got quite a few scriptures here at the beginning, and then we'll just kind of move on from there. But I want to establish these truths here. So wherefore he saith, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ will give thee light. It's a nice way of saying, get a revelation. Get a clue. Praise the Lord. You are something. You are powerful. You have import. You have impact. But unless you have this reality living in you and your awareness of it, you're not impacting anything. You're still having to operate by your intellect. Praise God. So look at 2 Peter now, chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. 2 Peter 1, verses 2 through 4. See, the beauty of this is, too, it isn't about you being, you know, religious, you know, ritualistic. It's about you being who you are. It's about you recognizing your true identity and then just living your life through that identity. You don't have to be a weirdo. I mean, you don't have to be super, you know, whatever. You just got to be you. You've got a personality that God created you with because he likes that personality because it can have an impact on certain people. It can affect other people. And you may say, well, I just got these flaws. Whoa. Welcome to the human race. Everybody's got them. The guy that Sheila's talking about, he doesn't want to come because he's an ex-drug addict. Well, where would he be more welcome than right here with an ex-drug addict preaching? But you see, in his mind, that's who he is. That might have been who he was, but that's not who he is. Praise the Lord. So grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us by that reality, we are given exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of that reality, of that divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. That's all talking about Christ in you, the Word of God, the promises of God, the reality of God, the hope of glory. You want that? He's just basically reasserting Colossians 1:27. Praise the Lord. Because you can have, we've got all the promises right here. But until you identify with those promises and realize those are yours, that's actually your identity, then they're just words on a book. They're just a fantasy. And we're just living out a masquerade. Praise the Lord. Christ in you, the hope of glory. The glory of God. Listen to that. The glory of God is the manifested Word of God. I'll say it again. Praise the Lord. The glory of God is the manifested Word of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Look at John chapter 1, verses 1 and verses 14. Okay, John 1:1 says that in the beginning was the Word. Right? The Word was with God. The Word was God. Okay? Verse 14 says, and the Word became flesh. Right? The Word became, it was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So what is he saying? He's saying just what I just got through saying. When the Word was made flesh, we saw glory. That's what they're saying. When the Word manifested, it was glory. We saw the glory. Hallelujah. Praise God. So the glory is the manifestation of the Word. It's the Word made flesh in our lives. Because otherwise, it's the Word. It becomes alive, it's quickened, it's made alive when we step out in faith and believe it and declare it. It manifests. And that, friends, is the glory of God. The glory of God is seen, amen, through answered prayer, through the finished work of the cross manifested through the Word of God. Praise the Lord. When you look at Jesus' ministry, you find that when Jesus spoke, he spoke the word. He said, I only say what my Father says. And what happened? Miracles, signs, wonders, healings, deliverance. That was the result. And the people said, we'll glorify God. People saw the glory, they saw the manifestation, and they glorified God. All right? Now, let's go a little bit further with this. John chapter 11 and verse 40. So when the word becomes flesh, God is glorified. What does God want? He wants to be glorified. So Jesus said unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldst see the glory of God? Now, he's talking to Lazarus' sister. Lazarus had died, and they said, well, Lord, if you'd have been here on time, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus said, now, look, if you'll believe the word, if you'll believe my word, you're going to see the glory of God. Amen? All right, look at verse 43 and 44, Roberto, same chapter. And when he thus spoke, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. And Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go. The word manifested. Praise God. For God so loved the world that he gave the word of God.
Amen.
Praise God. Jesus passionately loves you. With all of your flaws, with all of your stuff, he passionately loves you. Loves you in ways that we can't even express humanly. Because ours is always a kind of a reciprocal thing, even in the closest of relationships. There's always kind of a, you know, we need a little feedback. Which is what you saw this morning, praise the Lord, with early on. We're talking about Sally. We're trying to show the love of God. Amen? But you can't really do that outside of this awareness of Christ operating through you. Praise God. Jesus loves you. His Holy Spirit, it brings it out. In fact, God will move heaven and earth just to call you by name. In other words, just to have a relationship with you that's close enough to have a first name basis. Praise the Lord. Look at Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. Romans 6 and 4. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father. And look at that. That's what's important here in this message I'm talking about, at least. From the dead, by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. All right? Now look at Romans chapter 8 and verse 11. Romans 8 and verse 11. But if the Spirit of him, the Spirit of Jesus, if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by the Spirit that dwelleth in you. The Spirit that raised him up, the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you. He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Now, I know it sounds complicated when you think of it in this, you know, like the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus, the Holy Spirit. There's just one Spirit. Praise the Lord. Jesus was filled with the fullness of the Godhead. So the Spirit that raised him up was the Spirit of God, which is now the Spirit of Christ that dwells in us, which is also the Holy Ghost, which is the Spirit of God. Amen? It's not crowded in here. Praise the Lord. There's plenty of room because there's one Spirit there. Amen? All right, because another place the Scripture talks about one Spirit, one baptism, right? Okay, so just so you understand what I'm saying. So what? Here's my point. What Romans 6 and 4 calls the glory of the Father, Romans 8 and 11 identifies as the Spirit of God raising Jesus from the dead, or the Spirit of truth. My word is truth, right? What he's saying is the same thing that we're talking about. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Because he calls it hope in Romans 6 and 4, and he calls it the Spirit of God in Romans 8 and 11. It's the same thing. The hope of glory is the Spirit of God, or Christ in you. That's what raised him from the dead. That's what will quicken your mortal bodies. The same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will raise you up, will quicken your mortal body. Praise the Lord. The Spirit of Jesus, the Spirit of the Word. What does he say about the Holy Spirit? I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and he's not going to say anything except about me. All he's going to talk to you about is me. Who's me? The Word of God. Right? We were born of the Spirit. Born from above, right? When you get born again, Jesus said you got to be born again. What is born of the flesh is earthly, is fleshly. What's born of the Spirit is spiritual. So you got to be born again. You got to be born of the Spirit. So we're born of the Spirit, or you could say it this way, we are manifested spiritually into a material world. Does that make sense? We live, this is a material world, and we are born initially here materially, matter, right? But when we get born again, we're born again spiritually, but we're manifested, spiritually manifested into a natural world, into a material world. Praise the Lord. I'm not purposely trying to be confusing. I'm just trying to make this a reality for us to understand. We're in this world, but we're not of this world. Praise the Lord. We're spirit beings that have manifested into the natural world. We're not natural. We're supernatural, but we just happen to be in a natural environment. Praise the Lord. Now, here's the deal. Our actions often miss the mark of this creation, this new creation that we are, this spiritual being. And so the devil focuses on that missing the mark, or that not being focused on my true identity, which is a spirit being in a material world. He wants me to focus on my materiality. He wants to focus on my matter, on my flesh that fails. But that's why I got born again, because this always will fail. I can get it to do some stuff. I can fix it up to get it to do, you know, some things. But other stuff, it does its thing. Praise the Lord. I don't sound like I'm a quitter. I'm not. It's just that I've lived long enough to know. Like Paul said, Romans 7, harder I try, the better to be, the worser I am. The more I work at this, the more I'm faced with my failure. Praise the Lord. So Jesus spoke of the word as seed, did he not? He said the kingdom of God is like a man sowing seed. Now here, if you take a seed and you put it in the ground, most seed have a husk or an outer layer. And that husk will hinder the growth. But by watering it, by the watering of the Word of God, amen, by watering it, the life in the seed will displace the husk. It'll grow and it'll burst through the husk. That's the watering of the Word. That's why we go back to the Word of God. Husk is religion. Husk is like the flesh. It's like a blueprint. I worked construction, just rough-in carpentry work. I was never a finished carpenter or anything like that, but when I was going in college and when I first started pastoring in Ankeny, I worked with another guy building houses up in Ames, and so I was never a great carpenter, but I could pound a nail and, you know, lay some shingles and stuff like that. So that's what I did. But I did find out something early on. The blueprints don't always match the reality. If you ever get a, I don't know if you ever, see, you get a plan for a house, and all of a sudden you find out the bathroom doesn't have a door. You know, I mean, it looks good on the plan, But the reality is the plan isn't really dealing with reality. It's just somebody sitting in an office somewhere that designed it and didn't really look at it closely enough. And that's kind of the way religion is. It gives you a plan. It gives you an outline. But it's not real life. People have to live life. People have to go out there and do this. People have to go out there and be this. Amen? So you can't focus on the blueprint. You can't focus on religion. You have to focus on life in the Spirit. Praise the Lord. We want to find expression for our true identity. That is the hope of glory. That's the thing that's in all of us that pushes us on, that causes us to want to get more of God. We say more of God. You can't get more of God. You got all of God you can get. What you want really is expression of God. You want to be able to express that. That's taking it from the blueprint into reality, to where it's functional, to where the bathrooms actually have doors, right? Where it actually works. So the real hope is an expectation. An expectation of the glory. All right? 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Okay, he's got two up there. According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you could be a partaker of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world. It's expectation. See, Christ in you, the hope or the expectation of this reality. Praise the Lord. All right, but do I see it? That's the question. Do I see this? All right, I love that song just before the last song, Isaiah. I want to go to Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. We just sang that song, I've seen the Lord high and lifted up, you know. So Isaiah goes into the temple and in verses 1 through 3, and he sees the Lord. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne. How many of you know it's a throne of grace? Hallelujah. This is prophetic. High and lifted up, his train fills the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings, and twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, with twain he did fly. One cried unto another, saying, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. How bored do you suppose those angels are? It's not blasphemy, I'm just asking. That's all they do. Holy, holy, holy. I got to wonder if at some point they're not going, holy, 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 holy. Take it for me, Phil. I'm just exhausted. No, because what's happening here is every time they're looking at God, and we think, well, that would be boring. But each time they look, they see something different. Each time they look, they see Jehovah Sidkenu, God our righteousness. Holy, 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 he's our righteousness, you know? It's like a revelation. They look back. He's Jehovah Shalom, peace that passes understanding. Holy, holy, holy. They're experiencing these realities of God. Jehovah Jireh, provision. Holy, 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 nothing is impossible. God can provide all things according to his riches and glory. He's opened the windows of heaven and pouring out. Holy, holy, holy. Jehovah Rapha, healing, restoring limbs, organs, healing, deliverance, wholeness. Holy, holy, holy. That's what's happening up there. And it's not just the names of God. I'm just using those as a way of expressing this. But it's God, there's no end. He's an endless, infinite God. And every time you look, there's more. There's more to God. He's greater. He's beyond that. The last thing we thought we understood, and then you go, oh, holy, holy, holy. It's unbelievable. Okay, then the second thing is, what does the scripture say about us? We are seated with him. Now, Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. Amen. And we are seated with him in heavenly places. We're seated right there next to the throne of grace. The angels look to God, and what do they see? us. Holy, holy, holy. And then the scripture says, and the whole earth is full of his glory. Christ in you, the hope of glory. See, God sees what we're having an expectation of or wanting or hoping for, but to God it's already a done deal. So the angels look and they go, holy, holy, holy. They're everywhere. Right? And then the whole earth, they look at the earth. The whole earth is filled with his glory. You, me, every believer, everybody that's born again that has Christ in them, the hope of glory, they see the reality. They see the spiritual truth that we're striving for, that we're hoping for. But it's already a reality. Or they wouldn't be saying, holy, 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 the whole earth is filled with his glory. Christ in you, the hope of glory. All right, then in Hebrews 11, 1, you don't have to go there. It's, everybody knows the scripture, but it's now faith is the substance of things hoped for. How many of you know and realize that if you really were sold in or sold out or connected with this Christ in you reality, faith would not be a problem. The problem with faith is we think we're going to conjure it up somehow in the natural, and you're not going to do it. Our faith wavers based on whether we think Christ is in us or whether we think he might have left for a while because of the last stupid thing I did or said. Right? So faith is the substance of things hoped for. Faith is Jesus. It's faith in him. Not faith in me, but faith in grace. I can have all the confidence in the world because God has already done it. This isn't about me. It's about what he's already done. Amen? It's the expectation of that life that's in us that God's word declares about us. Faith is the substance of Jesus Christ, of Christ in you, the hope of glory. Praise the Lord. Titus chapter 2 and verse 13. I'm telling you, nothing will be impossible for you. If we get this, if we could get this really living in us and us being aware of it and conscious of it, the scripture's true. Nothing shall be impossible to you. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Now we look at that and we're thinking rapture, we're thinking, you know, the second coming. I don't know. You think whatever you want to, but I found that scripture has multiple layers of teaching and truth. And to me right now, he's saying looking for that blessed hope. That mystery. The hope of glory, looking for that hope of glory, the glorious appearing of our great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Not up in the heavenly somewhere, but right here where I'm at, in my life, in your life. Amen? The hope of glory. Christ in you. We ought to be looking for what Isaiah saw. We ought to be looking for the manifestation of the Word in us. What God filled the temple with. Glory. He wants us to experience Him. He wants us to experience life, not religion. Experience Him in ways that we've never experienced Him before. I'm going to tell you a story. You may think this has absolutely nothing to do with what I'm talking about, but in my mind it does. So take a little trip down freak lane here. When I was a kid, and I mean just a little kid, I was, I'll never forget this. It's bizarre the things you remember when you get old, you know. But I was probably five, somewhere around there, maybe six. Now I've got a brother that's 5 years older than I am. David, and you know, we worked from the time we were little kids. I wasn't—I I wasn't pumping gas then, but I, in the summertime, I had to pull weeds. The kind of mower we had, remember those old rotary mowers? Some of you remember the ones you literally pushed. Well, we had the latest thing. This is probably like 1953 or 4, somewhere in there. We had one, it was a rotary mower, but it had a motor on it. And the motor weighed about 150 pounds or something. I mean, it sat on top of the rotary mower, you know what I'm talking about. And that thing was heavy. It had a chain that was supposed to make it work, but it didn't work most of the time. I mean, to self-propel. So you basically pushed it. Well, my older brother, as I said, he was 5 years older than me, so he was like 10 years old or something. And he was mowing, but I couldn't make the thing move, so I had to pull weeds. So I'd pull weeds around all the buildings while he was mowing. But we were taking a break, setting up next to the back of the bulk plant or the place where they loaded the trucks with fuel and so forth. And we were sitting in the back there drinking a soda. And I told my brother, I said, you know, school's going to start, you know, next month or whatever it was. And I wanted to go to school. I wanted a Zorro. I read Zorro magazines or, you know, cartoons. We call them comic books. And I loved Zorro, you know. 5 years old, so give me a break. But honestly, in my five-year-old mind, I wanted a hat. I wanted that, you know, flat-brimmed hat. I wanted a mask. I wanted the cape, and et cetera. And I wanted all this, and that's what I wanted to wear to school. That's what I wanted to wear the first day of school. Now, my brother's 10. I'm 5, and I'm thinking, that's cool. You know, I mean, God, everybody would want to be my friend, right? Because, I mean, I'm Zorro, for crying out loud. And I'm just going to be so cool. And my brother, I can remember him, he just looked at me. He didn't say, you idiot. You know, I mean, come on. Zorro, first day of school? I don't think so. No, he didn't say anything. He just kind of smiled and nodded his head like, you poor sap, you know. God help you. If you get the Zorro outfit and go to school, I'll have to disown you or something. But I didn't get it. I mean, I wanted him to have one, too. I wanted us to both go, you know, like the dynamic duo, the dynamic Zorros, you know. Of course, he wouldn't have any part of that. And I didn't get the hat and the cape. And I was a little upset with him because he didn't get on board and really get excited about it like I was. See, I wanted a masquerade. I didn't know I wanted a masquerade. I thought that would be my reality, right? But in fact, I was wanting to masquerade. I was wanting to pretend to be Zorro. Okay? So I'm a little upset because my brother didn't have the same vision. And a few years later, I was in a really serious car accident with two of my sisters. And I had a really bad broken left leg. Broke it right at the joint, right in the knee. And I had a cast from my hip all the way to my toes. And when it finally came off, you know, your leg is about the size of your finger, and it just had little hair sticking all over, you know, scaly and just nasty looking. And weak. I didn't even know which foot to put in front of me when I was in the doctor's office. He said, okay, just take a step. And it was like, honest to God, I couldn't remember which foot to put out. You know, it was like, I don't want to put my weight on that weak thing. And then on the other hand, I didn't want to step out and put my weight on it either. So I'm kind of dumbfounded, like, okay, how do you do this again? I mean, remind me. Well, anyway, there was a whole process, and the therapy for this was a long process, but the best therapy was swimming pools, which was fine with me. You know, I was all on board for that. But there weren't a whole lot of swimming pools around at the time, but there was, I think it was Eastgate, or not Eastgate, but Easttown. So this might have been, I don't know, late 50s, early, maybe 60, if that, I can't remember now. But anyway, whenever it was, that's where I went. And I loved to swim. The problem was I didn't know how. And I just, you know, I thought I could because I just, you know, I'd get in and flop around. So I get there and I go out and I jump in the 6 foot part of the pool, and it's not, and I'm not 6 foot by any means, and I went like a rock to the bottom, and I tried to push myself up, but I didn't have enough strength with that bum leg to get horizontal in the water. Now, if I could have got horizontal in the water, I could have floated, because that's what I thought swimming was. I didn't have any of the actions down right. I just get in and float, but I couldn't get horizontal in the water for that to happen. So I just was, you know, trying to get up out of the water. So my brother yanks me out, and I was freaked. Praise the Lord. I wanted back in there where I could swim, but I was paranoid now. So I'm in the shallow water hanging onto the edge. I'm just kind of playing on the edge of the pool there. And I want to swim, but I'm afraid. So my brother gets out into the deeper part of the pool, and he said, float over here. So I'm freaking him, but I did it. So I get over there to him, and then he kind of helps me in this deep water. And I was still afraid of the water because it was over my head. But because my brother was there, I felt safe.
Amen.
I was flawed. I had a broken leg. I couldn't do what I wanted to do, what I would have given anything to do, but I couldn't do it. So I just trusted my older brother. Okay? Said all that for this. Romans chapter 8, verses 29 through 31. By the way, I did learn to swim that summer. I love water to this day. Growing up after that, I swam in every creek, every pond, every lake, every mud hole that I could find. I just loved the water. I still do. I loved it when I lived on the West Coast. I loved it when I lived on the East Coast. I loved the oceans. I love going to the lake in the summer. Sally will tell you, she doesn't swim a lot. I can't stay out of the water. I got to swim, you know. I got fish biting me. Literally, standing in the water, comes up and gets right on your nipple, you know. Honest to God. Flopping around like I'm bait. Didn't keep me out of the water. Kept me out of that spot, but it didn't keep me out of the water, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. He's our older brother. How many can say praise the Lord? Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Our older brother. Now we get overwhelmed with our flaws, with our junk, with our problems. But God has predestinated us, called us, justified us, glorified us. Praise God. Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's your reality, whether you can make a connection or not, that's still your reality. Praise God. God is in the midst of everything. Everything. He'll keep you safe, even when you're in over your head. Praise God. We're all flawed. But it's not about us trying harder. It's about resting in His grace. It's about trusting Him. It's about believing His word, what He says. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. Remember Isaiah? It was filled. Know you not, you are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwells in you. When you focus on Jesus, the temple is filled with His glory. Praise God. Grace, faith, forgiveness, mercy, all glorious. There's nothing to fear. You don't have to be afraid of your failures. You don't have to be afraid of your flaws. You just have to stay focused on Him, and the glory fills the temple. Single focus has to be Jesus. Praise the Lord. If I focus on me, I may have a really good day tomorrow. But it's almost inevitable that if I have a really good day tomorrow, Tuesday won't be so much. It'll come back to get me. Praise the Lord. So, you know, we're going to leave here, and life goes on. And if Jesus is only real in heaven or on Sunday, what good is that? If He's not real in everyday life, the swimming pool of our therapy. That's what life is. What good is it? Jesus is telling us, in one place he said, before Abraham was, I am. That's what he's telling us. I am. I am enough. I am all you need. I am sufficient. Manifestation comes as a result of that. It's all about Jesus. Well, God said, you know, he wouldn't share his glory with another. That's absolutely true. But you're not another. You and he are one. Praise the Lord. You've been brought into this. You've been made a partaker of his divine nature. His life. Now. Not when you get your act all together. Not when you get everything right. But right now. In the midst of all of your chaos, all your confusion, all of your flaws. It's Christ in you. As he is, so are we. I know this is just, it's beyond our intellect. As he is, so are we in this world. Now. That's how God sees you. Looking for the blessed hope is not future. It's looking for the blessed hope. It's looking for the hope of glory. It's looking for Christ right here. It's not talking about we're looking for something that's going to happen out there in the future somewhere. We're looking for it to manifest here right now in me, in you. It's our reality today. So maybe you're seeing water going over your head. Don't panic. Cast all your care on him because he cares. He cares. And if you'll do that, glory will fill your temple. The word will manifest. And those that are looking are going to see his glory. And then they're going to experience their salvation. Their rescue, his glory. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise
give the Lord a hand this morning. Praise God. Praise God. Amen, amen, amen. So, amen. Focus. That's what I'm always telling Clint right there, Bubba. Don't I, Clint? I'm always going, focus, focus. Focus on the Lord. Focus on him. And the glory will do what the glory does automatically as a result. Amen? Yeah. Trust him. Praise God. Amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate y'all being here this morning. Go in the power of his might. Hallelujah. Have an expectation of glory and see it come to pass. Amen. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. You're dismissed. God bless y'all.